special for her. But what caused my friend the greatest deal of stress, though, was worrying about what would happen to her mom once the wedding was over. For over a year, this one day was all her mom was focused on, all that she talked about, all that she seemed to be concerned with. So what would happen when that day was done and there were no more decisions to be made, no more details to fret over, no more celebration to get excited or talk about? What would happen when it was no longer there for her mom to be obsessed with? My friend was really worried about the letdown that her mom would face when all was said and done. And we can kind of understand that, can't we? Maybe not quite to that extreme, but think about every Lenten season that we go through. All of the different services, extraordinary music, planning and preparation, friends and family getting together, extra devotions to focus us and special meals to be cooked. It seems that we spend such a long time preparing for Easter to come, beginning way back with Ash Wednesday, then going through the fast and introspection of the 40 days of Lent, and ending with the ups and downs of Holy Week as we enter into Jerusalem with shouts of Hosanna, share a meal with Jesus and his disciples on Maundy Thursday, experience the pain and the darkness of the cross on Friday, all leading up to that Sunday morning of Easter. After spending weeks examining and preparing for the day, working on our relationship with God, focusing our hearts and our faith on God, Easter comes, and then in the blink of an eye, it's over. The proclamation that he is risen has been spoken, the ham has been consumed, the Easter eggs have all been found, and the candy has been consumed. So now what? Do we venture back into our pre-Easter lives, forgetting the hope of the empty tomb? Do we feel the post-celebration letdown that can happen after a big celebration? But my friends, we are still in the midst of the Easter season, that time when we celebrate Christ's resurrection. And so we should still be rejoicing, still be celebrating. Our hymns still come from the part of the hymnal that's marked Easter. The white paraments still adorn the altar, and I still wear my white stole. The text for today is from a space and time that is not 2 weeks after the resurrection of Christ, which is where we locate ourselves today, 2 weeks out of Easter. But it takes place on that very day of the resurrection. Did you notice that when Graham was reading it? It is still Easter. The wounds of Holy Week are still fresh and emotions are still raw. Most are still grieving the cross. In the death of Jesus, their hopes and their dreams seem to have died as well. Wasn't this man who was crucified supposed to be the one to bring revolution? Wasn't he the one who was going to change the political system and be their new ruler? And what had gone wrong? In addition to all those feelings were the normal feelings of grief and loss that accompany the death of a friend. Cleopas and his traveling companion woke up on that third day and looked at each other with one question. Now what? They had heard the news from the women in the tomb. They had heard the story about the angels and Peter's confirmation that the body was indeed gone. The linen wrapping was all that was left in its place there in the tomb. But now what should they do? Should they go back home, back to the everyday, pre-Jesus lives? What else was there to do? And so they took to the road, planning to go back and pick up where they had left off before they met this man called Jesus. Back to the fishing nets and the abacus machines and tax deadlines. Back to the human condition. They took on the road. It was about 7 miles from Jerusalem to Emmaus. They wandered and ambled, discussing the events from the week prior. Sometimes a good walk is just what we need to clear our heads, to work out a problem, to simply think something through. Sometimes when we have something big and serious to think about, putting it on that back burner of our brains and just moving our bodies away for a solution, it will present itself. Sometimes talking it out with our friends also offers us help. These two disciples had a 7-mile walk in front of them, a full day's journey to figure out how to answer the question, "So now what?" They had time to consider and contemplate, mull over their lives. They probably spent some time telling stories about their time with Jesus, that thing we do when someone we love has died. Saying maybe, "Do you remember the day that we were with him and he cast out the demons of those people and put them into the pigs? And then sent those pigs running over the cliff into the sea. The people in that town were so mad at us. I thought we would never get out alive. I'm still scared to go back there. Or remember the time he sent us out 2 by 2 and told us not to take anything we didn't need, and you tried hiding an extra snack in your bag just in case? Wow, he was not happy when he found out." And then he appeared to them, just walked right up to them on the road and interrupted their conversation, asking, "What are y'all talking about?" We know who it was. Luke knew who it was. But for some reason, these two were kept from recognizing the Lord. However, this question was astounding enough to stop them in their tracks. In today's time, their question would go something like this: "Seriously? Have you not been on Facebook lately? Did you miss the 5 o'clock news on Friday? Does the weekend paper not get delivered to your house? Do you mean to tell us you really have no idea what's happened?" And Jesus answers, "No, what's happened?" And so they begin to tell the story in response to this seemingly innocent question. Of course Jesus knew what happened. It happened to him. This was the man who was tried, convicted, crucified, and buried, and resurrected. If anyone could tell the story, it was Jesus. Yet he asked these two, "What's happened in these days?" And so together the three men walk the path to Emmaus, and Jesus listens to the disciples as they tell their tale, as they describe their heartbreak at the death of one who they thought was going to be the Redeemer of Israel. He listened as they glossed over the details that today was the 3rd day since his death and the tomb was empty. He heard the tone of their voices that nothing had really changed, nor would it. But Jesus knew as he listened that they just didn't grasp the significance of what had really happened. These two were asking, "Now what?" as if the end had come instead of a new beginning. The very beginning. And so he starts telling them about that beginning. He tells them about Moses and the prophets and the whole account of why this specific day mattered so much. He interprets the scripture for them. He breaks down the biblical code for them and does everything except slap a "My name is Jesus" answer is to move forward into the world. A world that is different because Jesus is still with them. And then as soon as they recognize him, he is gone, at least physically, from them. But they are not the same as when they sat down. The presence of the risen Christ has changed them, as it can change each of us. The Easter season is a time for us to recognize the risen Christ in our everyday lives. This is the Christ in whom we have our hope, in whom we place our faith. When we say we are people who know what it is to have grace, it is because of Christ. As these two men walked on the road, Christ was with them, even if they didn't recognize him. And once they did, they were forever changed. Luke does not answer the question for us, why didn't they recognize him earlier? The two knew the story, they knew who they sought, they knew the Bible and theology, and yet they didn't recognize him when he was right there in their own midst. There's a common story that pastors like to use as a sermon illustration, and I bet many of you have heard a version of it before, but just in case, let me tell it to you now. There was once a man who had a house, and one night he was watching the news on television, and the wedding forecaster announced that they were expecting a big storm and probably a flood. And so he encouraged people to evacuate immediately. But the man said, "Oh no, not me. I have faith that Jesus will save me." Well, that night it started to rain. It rained and it rained and it rained. And about midnight there was a knock on his door. It was the sheriff's department coming to see if the house had been evacuated. When the man opened the door, water came over the threshold. The sheriff told the man that he needed to evacuate immediately. The flood was coming, and it was going to be bad. If he didn't go now, the police were not going to be able to come back and help him later. But the man declined, saying, "Oh no, I have faith that the Lord will save me." The sheriff left, and the rain continued. The water was now rising quickly in the house, and eventually it covered the first story. The man climbed the roof of the house and clung to the chimney. His neighbor rode by on a boat, calling out for the man to get in with him so that he could ride off to safety. "Oh no, not me. I am a man of faith, and I have faith that the Lord will save me." The water rose, and as he climbed to the top of the chimney, a helicopter flew overhead and hovered over the man. They dropped down a basket for the man to climb into, but he refused, once again saying, "Oh no, I have faith that Jesus will save me." Well, eventually the waters overcame the man, and he had nothing left to hold on to, and so he drowned. When he got to heaven, Jesus was waiting for him, shaking his head in disbelief. "What are you doing here?" Jesus asked. "You weren't supposed to be here yet." The man said to him, "I am a man of faith. I had faith that you were going to save me. So what happened?" Jesus shook his head again and said, "I sent you a weather forecaster to warn you of the storm, but you didn't listen. I sent a sheriff's deputy to get you to leave, but you refused to go with him. I sent a neighbor in a boat to bring you to safety, but you would not get in. I even sent a helicopter to rescue you from danger, but still you didn't understand. What more did you need?" Even though this man's faith was strong, he didn't recognize the Lord at work around him. And how many times does this happen in our own lives? The times when Jesus is right there walking on the road beside us, accompanying us on the journey, sharing with us the good news, offering us resurrection, and we don't recognize him. Or the times when a friend or neighbor reaches out to us in Jesus' name, and yet we don't see it for what it is. Yes, as the people who know the risen Christ, we knew that there are others who will help us to see him when we can't. Even if we feel alone or isolated, even if we struggle to see him at work in our lives, there are others that can help us see. Cleopas and his friends were not alone that day. They had each other. Even when they left Jerusalem, they left together. They traveled as a team. When they dined together. They heard the good news shared together. And together, they raced back to Jerusalem to tell others what they had experienced. We are not meant to live in isolation from each other. One of my favorite movies is called The Music Box. It's this cheesy, wonderful film that was made in the 1970s about a man who has this boring, unexcited life. He works in a factory putting bottle caps on milk cartons. He goes home every night to his wife and son, who are equally dull and unexciting. But all that changes one day when he is visited by five heavenly messengers who put a new song in his heart, a song about Jesus. The song fills the man with joy, and all of a sudden his life goes from being ordinary and mundane to extraordinary and thrilling. Not because what he's doing has changed, but because of what's inside him that has changed. The angels leave a music box with the song, and every time the man opens it, he is once more filled with joy. But the man worries about what his family and co-workers will think, and so he hides the music box from them. They see he's been changed, but they have no idea why. Finally, after hiding the secret for a few days, the angels return and tell the man, "You're not supposed to hoard it. You're supposed to share it." And so the man does. He plays the music box at work and on the bus around town, in the elevator and on the streets. He shares the joy with every person he comes in contact with so that they too can be changed by that music. Well, my friends, we too have met the risen Lord on the road. We know the good news of the gospel, and we are not supposed to hoard it. The news of the risen Christ should be shared with others, and we are the ones called to be the messengers. As a community of faith and as a church family, we are called to find ways to show the hope we find in the risen Christ with one another and with all those that come in contact with us. We are called to share the good news with those who have not heard it yet, because the truth is, Easter is not over. In fact, this is just the beginning. And so let us go from here recognizing our risen Lord as he comes to us into our lives each and every day. Let us go finding him at work in others. Let us go to share the good news with all that we encounter on this journey we call life, not hoarding that salvation for ourselves, not keeping the good news close to us, but sharing it. So go knowing that the story of the resurrection is our story, all of us. Amen. When Jesus walked that road to Emmaus, he ended up sitting and sharing a meal with the two disciples. And it was in that breaking of the bread that their eyes were opened to see him. And that's what we recognize every time we come to the communion table, that when we break the bread together, it's a reminder of the love that God has shared with us, the grace that is offered not just to us, but to all people, not just to Cleopas and his friend 2,000 years ago, but to each and every one of us here today in 2022. And so as we go to the communion table this morning, let us again give thanks for what God has done in our lives, and let our eyes be opened to what God does right here and right now. Christ our Lord invites to the table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy,
holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he
who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. As often as you eat of it, do so in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took a cup, again gave thanks, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of God's mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and us gathered throughout the internet, and on these gifts of bread and cup before us. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. The body of Christ broken, that we might find new life in him. His blood shed for the forgiveness of our sins. For those worshiping with us from home and for those remaining in your seats for communion, you may go ahead and receive the elements now, the body and the blood of Christ given in his love for you. For those that would like to come forward, I invite you to do so in some sort of order. You all are pretty practiced at that, and so I encourage you to come, to remember, to receive.
Thank you.
you join me in the prayer after receiving? Eternal God,
we give you thanks
for this holy mystery
in which you have given yourself for us,
that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now we stand once more in body or in spirit and join me in our hymn, Freely, Freely. My friends, we have seen the risen Lord. So now what? Now go to share that good news, running to the people like Cleopas and his friend. Go to tell them that God's grace is for them as well. And as we go, may the blessing of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. Amen.